My name is Oscar Lavicena, and I'm going to be talking about problem number three, a bit binary algebra. First of all, we have the schematic here. We have seven inputs with A and seven inputs with B. And we have the output with each, which is S. We have seven outputs and a C out, which is the carry. Also, we have the zero flag, which detects when the other is zero. First of all, we're going to be seeing the other one bit. It's this schematic. And we have one input with A, another input B, the carry in, the carry out, and the output S. Here we have the truth table, when it's 0 plus 0 plus 0 means it's 0 on 0. And we have all the examples, and when it's 1 plus 1 plus 1, carry is 1, and the output S is 1. Here we have the timing diagram, we have different examples. Taking a look at the timing diagram, we see that in this example, A is 1, B is 1, carry in, we don't have a carry in, so it's 0, and because of that, the output S is 0, and the carry out is 1. We can see example there, 1 plus 1 is 0, plus the carry 0 means 0, and we have a carry 1. And in this example, the first of all, we have that if A is 0 and B is 0, and all the inputs are 0, the outputs will be 0, except for the 0 flag, which detects that all is 0, so it's 1. We have here the example of how an 8-bit adder would be. As we can see here, we have 8 1-bit adders, which result of an 8-bit adder, which is what we were looking for. We can see that an 8-bit adder supports a maximum output of 9 bits because of the carry. If we don't have a carry, we could be losing 1 bit because of an overflow. So you can see that we have the different carry-ins, which connects with the previous carry-out, until then the last one, which is just the carry-out, is not connected to another one. And we have the 7, the 8 outputs, which will give us the sum of the bits we were looking for. Okay. Also, we have the 0 flag, which is an OR negated. Well, as we can see, we have the true table of the NOR here, which is everything is going to be a 0, except if we have all the inputs at 0, which will give us an output of 1. An 8-bit adder supports an output of 9 bits because of the carry. If we don't have the carry, we can lose this bit because of an overflow. Finally, the maximum output that we can get in an 8-bit adder is the one you can see in the white box, which is 8 bits of ones plus another 8 bits of ones, which and I carry in positive, which means a 1, which will be 1 plus 1 plus 1, 1, we take a carry, 1 plus 1 plus 1, 1, we take a carry, we do the same with all the bits till we get to the last one, which will be 1 plus 1, 1 plus the carry. It's the last carry out we can see here, and the 8 outputs of the 8-bit adder. And that's all for the primary 3.
Hello, my name is Sanchez Coca, and I'm going to talk about the 10-bit adder in the B chapter 1. This is the chapter 1 we did in the first one we did, and here we have the symbol. This one, what does is, you have two entrants, you have the A, you have the B, and both of them, then they have 10 bits. You have the operation, if you have a 0, it would be an add, you will add the A plus the B, and you have you could have a 1 here in the OB, and it would be a subtract, so it would be A minus B. The S is the exit of the operation, and it could be 10 bits. Here we have the 0. The 0 means that we have a 0 at the exit. Okay, when we have here in the S a 0, is in the set we have a 1. And we have the overflow. The overflow you have here to take care about the if you pass the limit of your, for example, calculator. And here it is the carry. The carry is the one that you take for the other operation. Now we are going to talk about the internal architecture of the 10-bit adder. We have chosen two 4-bit adder and two 1-bit adder, okay? So here we have the extractor of our 10-bit adder. We have here the operation that you know that you, it can be 1 or 0. If it is a 0, it would be an add, and if it is a 1, it would be a subtract. So here we compare with the chore, the operation and the B, and it will change of the B. If you choose a 1 here in the operation, it would be minus B, and if you choose 0 here in the operation, it would be plus B here in the K. So here we have the A too, and they go the A and the K here to the first 4-bit adder. We have the exit of the 0 flag here, that would go here to this hand, and this hand would take this 1-0 flag, and this one of the 1-bit adder, they don't have the 0 flag, so we take the exit and we send it to the 0 flag. And if this is 0, it will be a 1 in the 0 flag part. Then we have the exit that will go by here, this one and the other ones. Here we will take all them to add. And this will be the exit of the 10-bit adder, introducing two entrants of 10 bits, each one.
Hi, my name is Javier, and I'm going to explain to you how to simulate the project that my colleagues already explained before me, how to simulate this project using Shilling's software. So, first of all, as my colleagues already explained, our project is to invent a 10-bit subtractor adder, which includes two types of chips. One chip is the 4-bit adder, and the other one is the 1-bit adder. So we're going to use two 4-chips adders and two 1-bit adders. So, to understand how we coded the 10 subtractor adder code using VHDL, we must know first that one VHDL file is enough to simulate our current project. So, first of all, we declare the inputs. So it's very important this part because as we can see, the inputs are A, B, and OP. So A is the number that we're going to introduce, and B is the other number, and OP is the operation that we're going to choose. So it's either the plus or a minus. And the outputs are R and C, which are the number resulting, and OV, which is an over flag, which means that it is out of range. And Z is when the result is going to be zero because there is no result. There has been a mistake. So how to code the 4-bit adder chip, for example. First, we declare its input, which is an AB, the numbers that we're going to introduce. And as we can see, A is a vector of 3 down to 0, B is the same, and C, this is the operation we're going to introduce, and this is the result, which is, in this case, the name is C4. And S, as we can see, is also a vector, and Z, it's a 0. In this case, if the result is 0, which means that there has been a mistake in the introduction of the values, in the calculator there will be a 0. Okay. Now, let's move to the timing diagram. So, how does a timing diagram work? Well, first of all, as we can see, the A and B that I mentioned earlier, which means that A is the first number that we introduced, and B is the second number that we introduced. So in this case, we have 1 and 1, and 0 and 10, 500 and 100, 10 and 4. Here, the operation. 0 is a plus, and 1 is a minus. The R is the result that I also mentioned before. So in this case, we have 0, which means a plus, 1 plus 1 is a 2, 0 plus 10 is a 10, 500 plus 100 is 600, 10 plus 4 minus, because we have a 1 here, equals. And this one is the overflow, which in this case is here because we have a 600 in the result, which means that if the operation introduced, we are going to need a 1 to save it for the next number. But in this case, we aren't going to need it. So how did we code this timing diagram in the Shilling software? So first of all, we declare the input. As we can see here, the A and B always A and B are always the inputs, as we declared here. So This is the binary number, and this is the second number in binary. And this is wait for main pulse, which means to wait for the operation to be done. And this is all. This is how the timing diagram works, and it's a coding, and it's coding VGDL coding language, and the same other subtractor VHDL code. This is what that I mentioned earlier. So this was our 10B2C subtractor other project. We hope that we understood it well, and this explanation was enough for the viewer to understand. Thank you.